So I will speak faster to make up for our delay.
It's,
I think, left over from prayers. So, thank you all for coming. Tonight's topic is Anan ben David, regarded by Karaites as their founding father. Karaism is a very important schismatic movement within Judaism that split off primarily in the 9th century and 10th century, and we're going to follow this movement to the present day. So I have to think of a joke to start off so everyone's in a good mood. I'm not sure if I can think of one, but I'll give you one anyway. So I hope I didn't tell this joke too recently, because as you know, I only have about 12 jokes and I just keep recycling them. But did I tell you the joke about the boy who goes to Europe in the 1920s to study in yeshiva? And he spends 6 months there studying in yeshiva in Poland, and then he comes back to live with his family. And the first Shabbos meal, so the father says, "Nu, you know, what was it like in Europe? What did you learn? What did you see?" And he says, "Well, you know, I met so many interesting people. Like, for example, I met a communist, I met a Zionist, I met an atheist, I met a socialist, I met a Bundist, I met a Beitarnik, I met a Jabotinskynik, I met a Menshevik, Bolshevik, and the father says, "So what are you surprised? It's a very diverse place." He says, "Dad, you don't understand. It was all one person." So, small joke, but it's intended to take us into this topic, which is a topic, an important topic in Jewish intellectual history. It has surprisingly modern ramifications, contemporary ramifications, for the development of Judaism in the 20th and 21st century. There is an interesting sort of resurgence of Karaism in certain parts of the United States, what Mr. Rodriguez calls neo-Karaism, and perhaps he'll explain what he thinks about that term shortly. But let's get right down to the subject matter. Today's lecture is sponsored by an anonymous donor. I'd like to thank that donor very much for supporting the shul that gives us the space to learn in. So, by a long applause. And it's wonderful that we have sponsors, but I'd like to say that your presence is sponsorship enough. I'm really happy that you're here so that I'm not talking to myself like I usually do. Okay, so, Karaism. The word, as we shall see, comes from the Hebrew term kra, kuf resh aleph, which is the basis of the word for mikra, or scripture. It's related to the word to read, or to call. And so Karaism derived this term primarily because of the extreme devotion to the biblical text alone, and put in one sentence, the essential belief of the Karaite movement is that the Torah, the first five books of Moses, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, are in fact given by God and nothing else. And the task of a Karaite Jew, or a Karaite, simply put, is to divine the divine intent buried in that text without the layering of rabbinic interpretation that followed, particularly in the oral tradition, and thereby live one's life as a Karaite Jew. That was kind of long for one sentence, but that's the kind of thing. The Bible and nothing else, really. The defining notion of Karaism is the rejection of the oral tradition. And this is crucial, and it is not original. We have had many movements in the ancient world that also took issue with the oral tradition, denying its authority. And in fact, one of the areas of Karaite scholarship in the 20th century is to try and connect this medieval movement with the ancient counterparts that preceded it. And there is some argument, for example, to say that it really follows a chain of tradition from King Yeravam, who rebelled against rabbinic authority as well, straight through the Middle Ages and to the modern day. It's probably baseless in terms of a direct connection. Nevertheless, there are certain sympathetic elements of ancient rebellion against rabbinic authority which are echoed in the medieval Karaite movement, so there's some argument for it. What is fascinating, however, is the rather extreme longevity of this movement, which has allowed it to persist right up until our own times. There's a general rule about the survival of schismatic movements within Judaism that I think is really quite true. It's something that Beryl Wine likes to say. He's a very important historian who actually is going to be here in Miami, I think, in February at the Young Israel Bal Harbor. He'll be here for as a guest of a Shabbaton, a scholar in residence, and I think I urge you to come and hear him because he's really fantastic. At any rate, he argues that, you know, we're, as a people, the Jews are very tolerant of heterodox ideas. We're very good at adapting to a wide variety of approaches to various elements of creed, and we don't have that many, you know, kind of bifurcations and multiple vectors of our faith that end up with lots of really powerful and dynamic polemics. However, one of the phenomena that Beryl Wine points out is the fact that when a movement splits off from Judaism, they're liable to continue unless they redefine the nature of who is a Jew. As soon as they change the definition of who is a Jew, they kind of like get onto another set of tracks altogether, and the separation becomes irreparable. That is certainly true of the Karaite movement, particularly after the 12th century, where Jews regard them as being, you know, traditional rabbinic Jews regard them as being perhaps not even Jewish, primarily because of their redefinition of the laws of marriage and the laws of conversion, things like that, that are essential to the definition of who is a Jew. Obviously, if you look at politics in American Jewish society in the, let's say, from the 1960s onward, with the large amount of outmarriage in the Jewish community, these kinds of questions come up again, and they're subject to heated debate. So perhaps when we take some questions a little later on, we'll see how this is relevant and useful for our discussions. Okay, so here we go. This is an interesting picture from a neo-Karaite movement, the slogan on the t-shirt, which is actually an 8th century t-shirt. They reproduced the way they look. Thank you. No, Karaites do it by the book, which is ironically true, right? It's all by the book itself. Anan ben David is sort of our starting point for today's lecture. He's really not the founder of Karaism per se. The Karaite movement later took hold of him as a figure and used him as kind of like an identifying flashpoint that began the movement. But in many ways, he was really quite distinct in his ideas from the Karaite movement, and they probably would have had a very hard time dealing with him individually. The way in which his movement started was most likely connected to a conflict over political power. It created, so to speak, a breakaway minion, a splinter minion that just went viral and created an entirely alternative movement. So let's look at that very briefly. First of all, let's set the scene. Where are we talking about? Mainly this happened in Babylon, which would be this map here, by the way. The arrows don't show the spread of the Jewish population. It shows the spread of Islam from its beginnings in the year 622 up until about the middle of the 8th century, which is where we're picking up the story. You can see that Islam starts here in Medina. They make a trip down here to Mecca, and then there's a rapid expansion across the coast of North Africa, eventually in the early 8th century into Spain, right up into the Pyrenees, and at the same time moving out into Persia and all the way out even further than this map to Bactria, Afghanistan, regions like that. The region that we're speaking about is the confluence of the Euphrates and the Tigris River here into the Persian Gulf, which is contemporary Iraq. Right around here in the lower part of these two really crucial rivers, this is classic Mesopotamia, right? The term Mesopotamia means between the rivers and refers to these two regions here, one of the oldest parts of the world that is civilized. And so there's a lot of Jewish yeshivot here in this region right down in the south. Famous cities like Sura, Umbedita, Naharda that are mentioned throughout the Talmud are located in southern Iraq, and that's where the Talmud was written during this time. So we have Jews who are living here in large numbers, and this is kind of like the equivalent of New York City of the 8th century. The northeastern quadrants of the United States, and maybe we should take a minute here, you know, we all, probably a lot of you in this room have family and relatives and friends who are in the Northeast, and let's hope that they're all well and that they weathered the aftermath of that horrible storm Sandy with success. So this is kind of like the equivalent of the largest diaspora community for the Jews in the 8th century. There's still Jews living in Jerusalem. There's a significant community living in the Nile Delta as well, with smaller communities developing throughout the Mediterranean basin. But this is really the main area of Jewish settlement. Spain will not really develop until the 10th century, when they start to exist as an independent unit, going into the golden era of Spanish Jewry. So this is the region we're talking about, 8th century. The organization of the Jews there were dominated by the so-called Geonim. The word Geonim comes from the word Ga'ava in Hebrew, which means pride. It can mean in a negative sense arrogance, but that's not the context used here. These are the titles that were given to the heads of the academies, or the yeshivot that were in these Mesopotamian towns. They had these rather large institutions. According to Talmudic accounts, they had perhaps as many as 1,200 or 2,400, depending on how you read the text, students, which is really quite significant for this time period, although those numbers may be considerably exaggerated and they may be really much smaller. But they are the prime expositors of the Talmud, which had been closed now for about 200 years. So the people who work with the text, the people who interpret the text, all questions of Jewish practice are directed to these Geonim, and they really run the entire show up until about the 10th century, when another group called the Rishonim began to rise, and you see them in European countries and so on. Now, related to the development of Ananism and Karaism. Ananism, by the way, should not be confused with Onanism. Totally different thing, those of you who study psychology. We will not have any lectures on Onanism. We're going to concentrate on Ananism. But the academy was a very elite institution. There was no tuition to speak of. There was no formal graduation. It was a kind of a loosely organized society, but it was a very strict meritocracy. In order to gain a position in the academy, you really had to demonstrate tremendous intellectual strength and be able to navigate the sea of Talmud with great facility, to work through the mental gymnastics of arguing the back and forth of the Talmud. And it was not a place for intellectual lightweights. It was a really serious place to study. The academies were arranged in rows. The seats were actually, literally, benches were arranged in rows, with the preceptor sitting at the front facing all the students and directing the lecture, kind of like a modern university lecture hall. But the seats were assigned by seniority and intellectual superiority. So there's a lot of discussions of, you know, which row was what, which particular rabbi is sitting in, and what happened when they moved him up one row. That's a big simcha, a lot of mazel tovs when you move up a row and so on. Not a place for the larger Jewish public, which had great significance for the rise of this movement. The way in which the academies reached out to the larger Jewish world were through these periodic, usually twice a year, phenomena called the Yarche Kala, which were like month-long adult education sessions, where the yeshiva would send out to many of the smaller communities, usually at those times of year when farming demands were not so high, and so the men in particular, there's really not that many opportunities for women, the men would come in from the fields, they'd have a little bit of extra time, so they would spend their day learning with the rabbis who are from the back benches in the yeshivot, who would go out and spread this information for them. However, you have the situation where there's an elite group of highly learned individuals who are like an island in a sea of largely illiterate Jewish peasants, perhaps with just enough literacy to manage their way through a prayer book, to observe the Sabbath more or less with the best understanding they have, but they're Amei Haaretz, to use the Hebrew term. They're people of the land, farmers. They do not have the opportunity to engage in full-time study, and so they're highly dependent on the Geonim and the Yeshivot. So this creates on one hand, it concentrates power in the Yeshivot, and it puts much more authority in those people who are able to interpret the Talmud. But on the other hand, you know, it leaves a lot of room for people who feel disenfranchised to vent their their feelings of perhaps rebellion or disagreement with rabbinic positions, and eventually to coalesce in anti-rabbinic groups. And this is precisely what happens in the 8th century. We see a lot of groundswell from the grassroots of people feeling the rabbis are too strict, or some of their interpretations are too zany. They just can't handle the way that the rabbis are handling the Talmud, and they really want to see a Judaism that, in many ways, for them, makes much more sense. We have to add to this the fact, if you're looking at this map here, I mean, it doesn't take much to imagine if Islam, now we're going with the actual colors here, if Islam spreads with such drama from 631 to 750, which is shown here on this map, like 120 years, where this tiny religion that starts out with one man in Medina suddenly takes over the entire Mediterranean basin, basically the entire known world of the time. I mean, there must be a lot to this religion to acquire such territory and so many adherents so quickly. And one of the hallmarks of Islam at this time was a much greater emphasis on reason over revelation. Certainly, Muhammad was a prophet in the Muslim understanding of the term. But on the other hand, they had many schools of jurisprudence that argued for a rational approach to the text and to religion in general. And that idea of reason appealed very much, kind of like an early scientific revolution, to the people of the Middle East at the time. Okay, so I've talked pretty much straight for 20 minutes, so let me pause for a couple of questions. Yes, Judith.
First of all, Islam spread very quickly. What was the religion of these nomadic, these people?
Well, that's an excellent question. What were the religions that they took over? Well, look at their scope. They spread over, you know, so much ground. They lived in territories where there were Jews and there were Christians active. There were a lot of pagans, particularly North Africa, a very pagan region. Zoroastrians, actually, I'm not sure if Zoroastrians.
That would be Persia.
That would be in Persia, right? And they're going all the way out to the east, where they have a huge popularity with Hindus, particularly with lower caste Hindus. So they're encountering all kinds of different faiths as they make their, you know, spread throughout the ancient Near World.
And my other question is that when you say the Karaites were rejecting the oral tradition and emphasizing and only reading the written, the Bible, that's the Tanakh, correct?
Not the Tanakh, the Chumash.
The Chumash.
Yeah,
just
the Tanakh is like 24 books, and the Tanakh is just the Tanakh is 24. The Chumash is just the 5, right?
So they're disrespect. They're not looking at the prophets or any.
Right. I'm generalizing, because one of the things that we see about the Karai movement is that, especially not under Anan but under a successor, it was also a heterodox movement and was also willing to tolerate different interpretations within a certain scope of parameters for those interpretations. And they did recognize, for example, the possibility of limited prophecy given after Moses, but not necessarily with the same commanding voice that the Chumash has. The later Tanakh does not have the ability to overrule the earlier Tanakh, the Chumash. Yes, Mr. Lax.
Is there an example of something that the rabbis tried to enforce that the populace just found intolerable or understand?
That's an excellent question. I mean, what is it that the...
Driving to Shul on Shabbos.
Yeah, driving to Shul on Shabbos is a good one. That's a good example. We have a lot of difficulty understanding because our sources are so highly charged with the fight between the Rabbanites and the Karaites. So anything you read from the period has to be viewed through the lens of whichever group is writing it. And I think the most interesting is, like, for example, last year we talked about Saadia Gaon, and he was a noted polemicist writing a lot against the Karaites, and unfortunately a lot of those manuscripts are lost, so we only have Saadia's arguments against the Karaites as they are preserved in the Karaite defense of those arguments. So we read Saadia through the filter of his enemies, which is kind of like, you know, we're in the election season, reading the polls from the websites of the other side, whichever side that is. So an example of something that the people rebelled at, you have a suggestion?
Yeah.
Yes, the spreading of Islam, excuse me, wasn't by force.
I'll get back to that question one second. Let me see. I was hoping you would help me out with this question, Mr. Lack. I can't think of one specifically, but I can guess. Because, you know, Shabbos is a really interesting one. Shabbos, the laws of Shabbos, as the Gemara says, are mountains hanging by a thread. Right? It doesn't say, in the Chumash, it says, you know, guard the Shabbos. And then it has a whole discussion of building the temple. So the rabbis make a huge leap to say, I mean, again, it's based on the oral tradition, based on the proximity of the commandment to observe the Sabbath and the intricate laws of building the temple, or actually the tabernacle, that it must mean that all these things that are okay for building the tabernacle, those are the things that are forbidden on the Sabbath. There are 39 different types of labor, and we can break them down, avos, toledos, and so on, and you get like thousands of things. So hang on, let me just finish this one here. So the I'm guessing from the intense discussion over the laws of Shabbos that that's probably one of the biggest areas. Ironically, though, the way the Karaites dealt with it didn't necessarily satisfy, because when you're dealing with the biblical text in a Karaite sense, you have to take the strictest possible interpretation in many cases. So, for example, it says in the Torah, Lo sivaruch esh b'chol moshvoseichem, you will not allow any fires to burn in all of your habitations, you know, on the Sabbath day. You can't light, you can't burn fires on Shabbat. So the rabbis, through the traditional oral Torah and its interpretation, they say, you're not allowed to burn fires means you can't start a fire on Shabbos. You can't light a fire on Shabbos. But if the fire is going from before Shabbos, then of course it's okay. You just let it burn right through. You don't interfere with it. But the simple text of the Pasuk says there shouldn't be any fires burning. So the Karaites say, okay, that's it. No more cholent. We're not having any hot food on Shabbos because you can't let the food cook overnight. And in fact, there are some rabbinic authorities that say it's a mitzvah to eat cholent to specifically reinforce the rabbinic interpretation of the pasuk. Okay, so regarding the spread of Islam.
No, yeah, but let me add something that you said.
Okay.
In our interpretation from the rabbinical midrash, I will start with the Tanoim. Actually, they put together a fence. That's the reason you got the Shabbat, you got the Kashrut. Uh-huh. The Kashrut, there's nothing in the Torah about Kashrut. It says, Lo sebasher din v'cherefimo. That's what it's doing. And now you got 600,000 different Tashkofim.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And this is something that sometimes I go off my mind.
Yeah, I'll tell you a joke about that. So the Pasuk he mentions is, you shall not boil a kid in its mother's milk. Which the rabbis understand to mean you can't eat meat and milk together, right? Even though, you know, you should be able to eat chicken and milk because chickens don't have a kid that you could boil in it and so on, but that's the way it goes. So the joke goes like this. This is my grandmother, Allah Shalom's favorite jokes. She used to like kind of these subversive jokes a lot. The joke goes that, so Moshe Rabbeinu, oh, and by the way, I forgot to tell you one thing, that particular phrase, you shall not boil a kid in its mother's milk, occurs three times in the Torah. And from the fact that it's repeated three times, the rabbis learn a huge amount of laws. It doesn't just say it once, it says it three times. There are no redundancies in the Torah, therefore, it must be there for the reasons. So my grandmother likes to tell this joke. She usually tells it with the punchline in Yiddish. It took me years to figure it out, but I'll say it in English. And the joke goes like this. So Moshe Rabbeinu is on Har Sinai. You know, Moses is on Mount Sinai, and he's receiving the Torah. He's learning the Torah from God. And God says, don't boil a kid in its mother's milk. Moses says, aha, so that means we can't eat cheeseburgers. Because it's the cheese and the burger. Okay, I got it. Then they're reading, and then God says, and don't boil a kid in its mother's milk. And then Moses says, oh, so that means that we have to have like separate plates between meat and milk because, you know, you don't want to have them. And God says, well, I just said, don't boil. And he says, oh, I get it, God. God says, okay. So the third one, he says, don't boil the kid in his mother's milk. And Moses says, so that means we have to wait 6 hours between having the meat and having the Haagen-Dazs. And God says, you know, Moses, just have it your way.
Right. There is something, Professor, something else. Actually, in this parsha in Vayero, Abram offers Chemo, Bada, and Ben Boko.
Oh, don't even, that's going to be a hard one, yeah. Because Abraham, I'm saying, he serves meat and milk, right? What appears to be meat and milk, and there's some interesting rabbinic ink spilled on that. Let's get past it, because it's a good one, but I think it will take us a long time. All right, I mentioned earlier that Anan ben David's rise to power is probably related to a political dispute. Now again, we have rabbinic accounts, Karaite accounts, they're very different. We don't have any third-party account that can give us a sense of it, but it does have kind of like the schmeck of truth, the feel of truth to it. There were two sources of power in the Jewish community in Babylon, two official sources of power. One was the Geonim, as I mentioned, the heads of the academies, and the second was the Exilarch, or in Aramaic, the Resh Galuta, the head of the exile, Rosh HaGalut, I guess you would say in modern Hebrew, but this is in Aramaic, you say Resh Galusa. We actually, in the Saturday prayers in the morning, we have a special prayer for the Resh Galusa, where we pray for him and for all his students and things like that. It's a very old prayer. The Babylonians, first the Sasanian Persians, and later their Muslim inheritors, had a great amount of respect for the Davidic line, and they felt it was appropriate that there should be a descendant of King David who was the official head of the Jewish community, the political arm, as you will, of the Jewish community, and he had official standing with the caliphate and represented the Jewish community at large, and there are a lot of tax implications and communal implications. The Resh Galuta was often at odds with the Rosh HaYeshiva, the heads of the yeshiva. There are many times when the Rosh HaYeshiva felt that a particular descendant of the House of David was disqualified for one reason or another from taking that political position, and quite often they will butt heads. In the Talmud, there are a lot of stories of the rabbis dealing with the Resh Galuta, and it's kind of an interesting sort of keeping their full arm's length distance from them. They can't alienate the Resh Galuta completely because the Resh Galuta is, after all, the head of the political community, but they're always kind of like looking down their nose at the ignorant behavior of the Resh Galuta. I shouldn't say always, but quite often you feel that kind of tension in the Talmudic stories that involve the Resh Galuta. At any rate, it was a choshuva position, an important position, and the story goes that Anan ben David was passed over for his younger brother to be the exilarch. We don't know why, but he was rather quite upset about this, and so he gathered together a group of like-minded individuals, and he led a formal protest against the rabbis, indicating that Judaism really should be completely different. The Talmud and its interpreters have gotten totally out of hand, and let's get back to basics. This is really what Judaism is all about, and he had some success with it. The rabbis, however, including his brother, complained to the caliphate, saying that, you know, this will not do. This is a picture of an Ottoman caliph. I love that hat. I think I would love to wear a hat like that. It would not be a good hat for high winds, but I think it would be a really fun hat. At any rate, so...
It looks like the origin of Halloween.
Yeah, maybe this is a Halloween hat. You know, the original was orange. This is a black and white reproduction, but orange would look better. At any rate, so they complained to the caliphate saying, hey, Anan ben David is causing a lot of trouble, and the caliph imprisoned him. While he was in prison, again, this is the Karai account speaking now, he befriended another fellow prisoner who later was released and founded one of the great rationalist schools of Muslim jurisprudence. And this particular Muslim said to him, listen, why don't you just go to the caliph and tell him that you represent a distinct religion, that you're not trying to lead the Jewish people, you're trying to lead the Karaite people. Mm-hmm. And in fact, according to the Karaite account, this was accepted by the caliph, he was released, and he went on to create this movement. This interesting kind of question over what is Karaism? Is it Judaism? Is it correct Judaism? Is it something distinct? Will repeat itself throughout Karaite history, right up until the 20th century in particular. So when he got out, he created this movement, and he had a certain number of followers. what exactly is it that that they believed in? So one thing we have to realize is it is impossible to live by the Bible without any interpretive tradition. As we saw last week, there are just too many ambiguities that are present in the written text. There are too many omissions of key data, like, for example, keeping kosher. You know, we're supposed to keep kosher, but we don't have a lot of details on it. There are too many passages which have an incredibly harsh interpretation if you read them simply on face value. So in the rabbinic tradition, all of these problems are dealt with in great detail and with great sophistication, and they're expressed in the form of the Mishnah and the Talmud, and it makes for a workable religion, a religion that has survived, after all, for 3,000, 4,000 odd years now, with great success, although with no major league football players. I thought that was funny, but it came to me too fast. We'll rewind that and try that. Okay. So, the oral law is inevitable. The Ananites and later the Karaites rejected the rabbinic form of the oral law, but then they found that they actually had to create one themselves anyway. They had to have something to fill the gap. Like I mentioned last week, you know, if they wanted to observe the holiday of Sukkot and it said, bring to shul the fruit of a goodly tree, everyone's showing up with different fruits, bananas or apples or cherries. You know, no one's bringing an esrog. So it's very hard to, like, focus the movement if you can't define these ambiguities and so on. And also, you consider the lex talionis, the law of the tooth, which reads, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, burn for burn. You know, that's a really hard law to enact exactly as written. Even if you want to read it exactly the way it is, you know, sometimes the punishment is not, it doesn't fit the crime at all. It's disproportionate. Like, here's another joke. I don't know why I have three jokes in one night. I didn't tell jokes for 2 weeks, and now here's a joke. The joke goes, God comes to Shloimeh in a dream and says to him, Shloimeh, you know, you've been such a good man, you've been a mensch, you've taken care of the poor, you've clothed the sick, you've done all kinds of things, you know, I am going to reward you, you're going to get whatever you wish for, you will get. But there's only one thing, God says to Shloimeh, I'm really sorry to have to tell you this, but I'm upset with your ongoing feud with Reuven. You and Reuven have been fighting for years, and it's really got to stop. So this is the deal. It says, Shloimeh, I am going to give you one wish. You can have whatever you want, wealth and wisdom and whatever. But whatever you wish for, Reuven will get double. You want $10 million, he'll get $20 million. You want, you know, encyclopedic wisdom, he'll get double encyclopedic wisdom. Whatever you want, he's going to get double. So what's it going to be, Shloimeh? So Shloimeh thinks for a while and he says, I'd like to be struck blind in one eye. Right. So, why did I tell this joke? I'm not exactly sure why I started it, but I got on the ring and went that way. So, the thing is, they had to have some kind of oral Torah. They called this the Sevel HaYerusha, the burden of the inheritance. That, you know, what can you do? You can't get away from it. You have to have some kind of tradition to interpret these things. Otherwise, nobody knows what to do because the biblical text alone is not enough. It amuses me sometimes when, you know, politicians and sometimes religious figures on the right will say, and I mean, like, not Jewish necessarily, but they say that they live by the Word of God. And I don't think that's possible. If you think the Bible alone is the Word of God, you're going to be in a lot of trouble because there's so many things that need explication and interpretive tradition in order to live by. So, as the rabbis put it in their accounts, they said that that Anan said to the Jews, forsake ye the Mishnah and the Talmud, and I will compose for you a Talmud of my own. In other words, he would replace the current rabbinic Talmud with another one. Now, the kind of ways in which they ultimately did create their own oral Torah, so to speak, there's a few different hermeneutic principles that they applied. So, for example, and this is an article from the Encyclopedia Judaica, they used, one, the literal meaning of the biblical text, as we've discussed, what it actually says. Two, they used the consensus of the community, right? Much more populist kind of approach. They said, you know, okay, what does everybody think this verse means? Everybody who says it actually means poke out that person's eye, put up your hand, and they would take a vote, and they would see, you know, if there was wide-scale public opposition to that particular reading of it, so they wouldn't accept it. Third, the conclusions derived from Scripture by method of logical analogy, using the Hebrew term here, hekesh, which means connection, which is a term used in the Talmud as well, that, you know, if the Bible says it follows like this over in this condition, then over here in a similar condition, it must also be the same. And then finally, knowledge based on human reason and intelligence, what they called chokhmat hadat, right? This seichel, right? But it was not universally accepted by Karaite scholars, because on one level, although this is in some senses a more rational approach, because they want to like start over and reject the rabbinic interpretation, which they feel has become too extreme, and they want to try and reason it out themselves. But on the other hand, if you're going to reason it out themselves, then what's the point of sticking so closely to the biblical text in the first place? The biblical text is supposed to be, you know, inviolate. So how can you go and change everything like that? Anan, in particular, tended to be very strict and very ascetic, which is one of the reasons why he really wasn't too successful, and it had to be a successor who would really take Karaism to a new level. But he advocated, for example, long Muslim-type fasts for a large part of the year, and he was rather, unlike his successors, he was rather unable and unwilling to accept divergent opinions. Yes, Ms. Abramson. No, what they think of as their Talmud, and they certainly didn't use that term. That's a rabbinic source putting it into rabbinic terms. They were hoping to create a definitive reading of the Bible, which would be permanent.
So how
was
that?
So they would change the
what the rabbis did.
Yeah.
No, the rabbis also engaged in the same task. I mean, the rabbis involved in the Mishnah and the Talmud, they felt that, yeah, this is the document that's for all time. And we still use the same Talmud. You know, ours works.
I understand for that, but the Karaites, in their perspective, how are they different? They just think that they got it all wrong, or that...
They felt that the rabbis had perverted the text. And for various reasons, their Talmud takes them to certain directions. Like, for example, when you read the Talmud, you see that there are multiple opinions, and sometimes one of them is accepted for the definitive law. What happens to the other four? How come we didn't accept any of those opinions? You know, so there are choices made in the Talmud. And the reasons why some opinions are favored over others is essentially the whole engine of rabbinic scholarship. Why Rabbi Yehuda wins this argument and he doesn't win over here, and so on. It's a larger question than I can answer beyond that very briefly. Okay, yes, last question, then we better move on.
No, what struck me something is you got the Torah Shebalpeh and Shebikhtav.
Yeah.
At what time the Shebikhtav started, the written one? This is a question that bothers me like crazy.
Well, you'll see different Mephorshim will approach in different ways, but it's understood basically throughout the life of Moshe Rabbeinu once the Jews were... had left Mitzrayim.
It wasn't Ezra and Nehemiah when they came back, because what did they study before? Nobody studies anything in the time of the Shoftim and the Nevi'im.
Oh, you know, I'm not even a rabbi. You have to ask a rabbi that question.
Oh, no.
I can get in trouble with the rabbinical union if I say anything. Okay, so let's go into Karaism specifically. As I mentioned earlier, it's from the root kra, right, to read. What the Karaites really like was, and this is a movement that came up about a century after Anan, is that, you know, he really focused the argument and really said the problem we have is with the rabbis. We don't like the way they're lording authority over us, and we want to take off in a different direction. They had a huge impact on biblical scholarship of the time, because if the Torah itself is really the sole authority, then you know what? Let's go back and study the Torah very deeply. And the rabbis also, of course, studied the Torah with great depth, but there was a renewed emphasis on studying, for example, Hebrew grammar. Without simply taking it for granted that this is what these words mean, the Masoretic movement in particular, which was a rabbinic movement, but which was influenced by Karaism as well, said, okay, let's go back and let's unpack all of these words and let's try and determine how they should be pronounced precisely and why is it written with an aleph and pronounced with a vav and things like that. A huge amount of scholarship, which rabbinic Jews use today, every single day, is very much tied to the impetus that Karaites began. The successor that is most important for the development of Karaism is Binyamin Nachmendi. He's in the middle of the 9th century. And he took a lot of Anan's ideas, but he was a much more populist thinker, and he was much more tolerant of divergent opinions, much more open to the idea that, you know what, there can be a lot of different Karaisms. It doesn't have to necessarily be one, you know, Catholic church, so to speak, of Karaism. And this was a very wise move that allowed the movement to kind of separate itself from the extreme asceticism you find under Anan, with the long fasts and the cold food and things like that. And they began to, you know, to really develop themselves as a movement at the time. There's also an interesting kind of overlap with Islam as well, because they portrayed themselves as the new intellectuals. They portrayed themselves as, you know, the much more clear-thinking, less fanatical individuals, even though today we would look at them perhaps and understand them as fanatics, you know, going straight to the biblical text with minimal interference. But nevertheless, in that time, they had a lot of support from Muslim authorities, and one can imagine the groundswell of popularity in that context. Look, here's where they're basically settled. So we've got a lot of them here in Babylon from the 9th to 11th century. The next major growth section is in Israel, and especially in Cairo, in Egypt, which has a long community that lasts right up until the 20th century. You have some that settle out here in the far west, Spain and North Africa, and a significant amount of Karaites settle in Byzantium, which is Constantinople, Istanbul, the center of the Ottoman Empire. Again, about 600 years worth of Karaite communities. Fascinating little pockets in the Russian Empire, specifically in Lithuania, a little bit in Poland, not mentioned here, and also in Crimea, which is right over here. I'm not sure why the arrow points over here. I didn't make this map, although I kind of like the sort of Gothic script here. The Crimea is this little spit of land that goes into the Black Sea, and these communities exist right up until the 20th century. We'll talk about them momentarily. The spread of the movement from the 10th to the 12th century is pretty dramatic. We know a lot about them because of the Geniza, which I'll talk about in 1 second. I've already mentioned how their scholarship had a tremendous impact on the study of the Bible among rabbinites as well, because rabbinites don't want to get caught off guard, you know, by Karaite arguments about reading the biblical text. They want to make sure that their understanding of Hebrew is just as pristine as the Karaites as well. And during this period, especially the 2 centuries, from the 10th to the 12th century, there's a tremendous amount of back and forth. Huge literature develops. The Karaite movement is expanding and attracting proselytes, attracting converts, and so the rabbis have to be involved, Gesundheit, in arguing against them. The Karaites write apologetic literature that brings more Jews to the movement, and it's perhaps the strongest period of the Karaites to date. Now, a lot of the source evidence that we have about the Karaites comes from the Geniza. I'd like to take just a moment to make sure you're all aware of what the Geniza is. I know those of you who were here last year, we talked about it, but it's worth repeating. In Jewish practice, we have a halakha that you cannot discard anything that has sanctity. So a Torah scroll, for example, has to be buried in a Jewish cemetery when it's no longer useful. Holy books, things like that. And in fact, anything that has the name of God written in it, hence the word shemos, or shemot, which means names. Anything that has the name of God written in it has some sanctity, and therefore it has to be treated properly. It can't simply be thrown in the trash. And so many synagogues homes, schools, and so on have a special area they call the geniza, which means literally storehouse, or, you know, lignoz means to hide away, and they'll store up all their papers and books and things like that until once a year, so usually before Passover when they clean out, they ship it all away to be buried or taken care of in a similar manner.
Okay, when part of it, when anything that had the Hebrew alphabet.
Exactly.
The
so this
father that only be names.
So
father, that's why we have so much letters and things that, you know, the father wrote to a child or
that's precisely the story of the Geniza. So let me tell everybody else, though. I'm glad you remember. It's, you're absolutely right. There's this town outside of Cairo called Fostat, and they had this strange custom, as Ms. Deweiser says, that not only holy writings should be put in Geniza, but anything written in the Hebrew script. Even if it was written in Judeo-Arabic or in Aramaic, and even if it had nothing to do with religion whatsoever, it was a business contract, it was a personal letter, it was a little shopping note, honey, please pick up some pita on the way home from the shuk, right? Whatever it is, they would not throw this away because it was written in Hebrew, and so they would throw it all in this tiny little attic here. Here you see the entryway to it. It was on the second floor of a synagogue in Fostat, an ancient synagogue, like 900 years old, and it was sealed up. And there was a legend, when it was sealed around the year 1300, there was a legend that there was a huge serpent up there that would bite anyone who went into the Geniza. So this effectively kept the Geniza closed until the late 19th century, when little bits of pieces began to appear on the black market, and people were saying, where did you get this manuscript? And eventually it was tracked down to this one synagogue. They opened it up and they found the largest trove of documents from the Arabic world ever, bar none. We have about 100,000 fragments from Arabic sources. There are 250,000 fragments, more than 2.5 times, in the Geniza, representing all of this history. So it's ironic, but medieval Arabic historians have to learn Hebrew in order to study the period because they need the Geniza sources to understand what's going on. And they're, of course, always written somehow involving Jews because of the script. What the Geniza tells us about Karaites is fascinating. And S.D. Goitein is the principal scholar. He devoted his entire life to studying the Geniza documents, and he wrote this massive work called A Mediterranean Society, which is all about what life was like there for about 500 years from 800 to 1300. One of the things that's striking about the Karaites is that the Rabbanites and the Karaites actually got along fairly well. There are lots of marriage contracts between Rabbanites and Karaites. I know, it's amazing.
Jews,
right?
No?
Well, they're Jews, but they have different laws of Gitin, so they could be Mamzerim. They have different laws of Gerus, so they might not be Jewish at all. There's all kinds of things that how do you know they're Jewish? How do you know that it's a misafik?
The laws of Yud, for instance, in the Torah, are not the laws that we have today, that the rabbis, you know, decided on. But what you have on the Torah is not as demanding.
Correct. If you look in the Torah, we don't even have laws of conversion in the Torah. It refers to the ger and the ger toshav. How do they get that way? I mean, what do you do with those people? Later, when you look in Tanakh, you see, for example, the story of Ruth that has the most extensive discussion, and basically the rabbis really take it apart to get to where we are today with gerus. But how do we know that they accept these things? Like, I'll give you an example. There are three basic things for gerus. Two for women. For everyone who wants to become a Jew, they must immerse in a mikvah. For men, prior to that, they have to have a circumcision. This is what they call the snip and dunk. And then after that, this is the tough part, they have to accept the commandments, Kabbalat HaMitzvot. So what does that mean to a Karaite? Certainly not the same thing as a Rabbanite. So you would think, today for sure, you won't find... Okay, I take it back. You will find rabbis who will marry rabbi who will marry rabbinites to Karaites, but you'll also find rabbis who will marry alligators to fish, so it's not necessarily a good example. But you would think most of the rabbinic literature says that Karaites are totally off the map. They're not, they're chutz lamachane, they're outside the camp. But when you look in the Geniza, they're marrying each other, and they're creating rabbinic contracts and saying, okay, my rabbi will serve at this part, and your rabbi will serve at that part. Amazing degree of cooperation, business cooperation, they're forming partnerships.
I think it was a survival kit. It was a survival kit.
A survival mechanism for them? It's possible. They're not that embattled a minority, though, and it lasts for a long time. So it's
a
survival.
There was a lot of threats into the community, especially the Islamic threat at that time. So when apparently in Jewish history, when you have a lot of threats, then you reunite
you pull
yourself,
together.
You come together, then yeah. You spread in different ideologies. But when you have a little bit of community,
yeah, it's quite possible.
And it's political also. It's
yeah, and
who has the power?
Right. And you see it also in small communities in America too, where you know the arguments between Orthodox and conservative reform tend to be much sharper in big cities where we have enough Jews to fight amongst ourselves. But in small towns, you know, you want to get along. So that's a good argument. I agree. Yes.
What language do they use, the Karaite?
The Karaites, it depends on the region that they're living, but...
Do you have like Ivrit or something like it, Aramaic?
You know, I'm not sure what they used among themselves. By the time they are active, Aramaic is on the decline, but on the other hand, they're great lovers of the Hebrew language as well, so I'm not sure. That's an excellent question, but I don't know the answer. Okay, let me move on, because I'm concerned about the... about the time. So Karaism, though, after the 14th century, it really starts to go into a slow decline. There's a little bit of a resurgence when printing is invented, because you know, once again, the reattachment to the word and the dissemination of the printed word is very significant. But it's a slow decline. There's also a widening separation between the Rabbinites and the Karaites that looks more familiar to us today. This is, by the way, one of Mr. Rodriguez, probably Neo-Karaite, or more than the International Institute of Crimean Karaites, founded in the USA, January 2001. I wonder what all these symbols mean. I don't really know. I just pulled it off the web. But at any rate, a couple of interesting little tidbits of information. The Russian Karaites, the ones that are living in the Russian Empire, particularly in the Crimea and in Lithuania, get an interesting kind of dispensation in the 19th century. Under Tsar Nicholas I, there was a lot of persecution of the Jews, and the Karaites successfully petitioned to be considered a separate religion from Judaism. But the Tsar would not, he still considered them Jews, but he did consider themselves a separate religion. So Jews of a different religion, Karaites. And the real key advantage to this was that they were exempt from many of the poll taxes the Jews were exposed to, as well as the horrific conscription regimen, the so-called cantonist decrees, where the Karaite children were not taken away and sent to serve in the army for 36 odd years. So they, and actually, this is repeated once again, one of the more heroic moments, in my humble opinion, in the Holocaust in Eastern Europe. Heroic from the perspective of scholarship. Philip Friedman was a survivor of the community of Lvov, of Lviv in Ukrainian. It's in southern Poland. And he writes of a moment when the Nazis invaded and they encounter these Karaites in Lvov, in southern Poland. And the Nazis themselves were apparently uncertain, what do we do with the Karaites? Who are they? Now, unlike the Russians, who consider them Jews, but of a different religion, the Karaites were arguing that, no, we are a different people. We're not even Jewish, because for the Nazis, race was primary, and who cares what religion they are? If they were Jews, they were racist. So, Professor Friedman, writes in one of his books on the Holocaust about how the scholars of Lvov got together and formally let the Nazis know in a memorandum with lots of scholarly sources that the Karaites are definitely not Jews. And the reason they created this scholarship, so to speak, is specifically to save their lives, which in fact they did do. It's a, you know, one of the more useful ways that professors can use their knowledge.
So Hitler didn't torture.
So Hitler did not kill the Jews, the Karaites of Lvov. They were exempted. The Jews, and including those who wrote those documents, were not exempted, but at least they were able to save these other human beings. Karaism today, here's a another one of those 8th century t-shirts here that says, you know, Karaite in Hebrew. Egypt maintained a significant population right to the 20th century. After the founding of the State of Israel, they found themselves under significant persecution, and so they made their way to Israel as well, where there are possibly as many as 30,000 of them. These are Karaite estimates, and they're most likely way too large, maybe, you know, five times too large, but there are definitely a few Karaite communities scattered throughout Israel. They have difficulty integrating into Israeli society. Their calendar, for example, is different from the rabbinic calendar. There are certain holidays that they're totally missing, like Halloween, for example. And no, so like Hanukkah, for example, that they're totally missing. Their children are deprived, and they feel stigmatized. It's not surprising because, you know, the Rabbinites really are victors in the conflict between the two groups. But that's essentially where we have it today. An interesting kind of footnote to the development of Judaism and the persistence of the movement today.
Are they going to the army?
That's a good question. I do not know if they go into the army. They do?
Okay. I'm asking you.
I don't know. The Yati is saying yes. Let me thank you all for your attention and your indulgence. And I hope you have an excellent week.